You're watching Tag TV.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show. In a rare occasion of cooperation, India and Pakistan, the perennial foes, have opened a religious corridor along their border which will allow pilgrims from India to go across and visit a Sikh shrine in Pakistan. It will be a visa-free access to the Pakistani town of Kartarpur, a place which marks the site where the founder of Sikhism, Guru Nanak, died. Prime Ministers Narendra Modi and Imran Khan participated in two separate ceremonies held on the either side of the border. A report.
Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi flagged off the first group of Sikh pilgrims crossing into Pakistan to visit a temple following a border crossing agreement between India and Pakistan. The pact between the nuclear-armed neighbours allows visa-free access from India to the Pakistani town of Kartarpur. During the official opening ceremony for the crossing on Saturday, Modi thanked his Pakistani counterpart Imran Khan for understanding Indian sentiments and acting accordingly.
गुरु नानक देव जी के 550वें प्रकाश उत्सव से पहले इंटीग्रेटेड चेकपोस्ट करतारपुर साहब कॉरिडोर इसका आरंभ होना हम सभी के लिए दोहरी खुशी लेकर के आया है। मैं पाकिस्तान के प्रधानमंत्री श्रीमान इमरान खान नियाजी का भी धन्यवाद करता हूं कि उन्होंने करतारपुर कॉरिडोर के विषय में भारत की भावनाओं को समझा, सम्मान दिया और उसी भावना के अनुरूप कार्य किया।
On the other side, Pakistani Prime Minister Imran Khan inaugurated a crossing for Indian pilgrims visiting a Sikh shrine in Pakistan. Hundreds of Indian pilgrims and delegates, including former Prime Minister Manmohan Singh and politician and cricketer Navjot Singh Sidhu, arrived for the ceremony. Congratulating the Sikh community on both sides of the border, the Prime Minister said he was happy to see the pilgrims being able to perform their rituals. Earlier in the month of October, senior officials from both sides had signed the agreement which envisaged the terms of travel to the religious site. Both the countries have decided to keep the corridor open throughout the year.
बहुत अच्छा लग रहा है, इंतजाम बहुत सोना होया है, बहुत ही सुविधाएं दितियां ने बाहर दे आने वाले यात्रियों नूं बहुत ही सुविधाएं दितियां ने ठहरन दियां और सब जिन्हां सुविधाएं ने बहुत अच्छियां करके दितियां ने उन्होंने।
The Punjab region, the ancestral home of the Sikh faith, was split between India and Pakistan at independence from Britain in 1947. Many Sikhs then migrated to India. Sikhs in India have sought easier access to holy sites in Pakistan ever since. Visas to travel between the two countries often take months to process. The two countries hope that when fully operational, some 5,000 pilgrims will be able to cross into Pakistan every day through the new checkpoint, a huge increase on current numbers.
Moving on to Afghanistan, where the Kabul establishment has been making efforts to bring Taliban to the negotiating table. In its latest reach out, it decided to release three Taliban prisoners in exchange for two professors who are under Taliban captivity for more than 4 years. A report.
In yet another reach out to Taliban, Kabul establishment has decided to release three captured Taliban in exchange for two professors from the American University of Afghanistan. The two professors, one from Australia Timothy Weeks and another from the United States Kevin King, both faculty at the American University in Afghanistan, a vault compound in the capital that's been targeted multiple times in the past by Taliban, were kidnapped in August 2016 and are under their captivity since then. The prisoner swap is part of a wider effort to start direct negotiations between the Taliban and Afghan government.
تصمیم گرفتیم که 3 تن از زندانیان طالب را که از کشورهای بیرون در همکاری نزدیک و همه جانبه شرکای بین المللی ما دستگیر گردیده و از مدت بدین سو در توقیف خانه بگرام زیر نظارت دولت افغانستان بودند به طور مشروط از بند رها سازند. این 3 نفر عبارتند: آجی مالی خان دیوالی خان زوی، عبدالرشید محمد عمر زوی، انس دجلال الدین زوی.
Two of the three Taliban being released are Hafiz Rashid and Anas Haqqani. Haqqani is the younger brother of Sirajuddin Haqqani, the leader of the Haqqani network, the most deadly faction inside the Afghan Taliban. Earlier this year, the Taliban said Anas Haqqani would be a member of any negotiating team that dealt with the United States and demanded his freedom.
در مشوره با شرکای بین المللی افغانستان و به خصوص ایالات متحده امریکا ما میکانیزم و روش را در پیش گرفتیم که رهایی مشروط این 3 نفر به معنای تقویت صفوف دشمن و تشدید عملاتشان نخواهد شد. تدابیر مشترک بین ما و شرکای بین المللی ما چنان است که این تصمیم دشوار اما قابل درک بتواند هم قوت ما را به نمایش بگذارد و هم نیت ما را که خواهان صلح هستیم و برای اعتماد سازی آغاز مذاکرات رو در رو و حل صلح‌آمیز این بدبختی توان و اراده اتخاذ تصمیم های سخت و جدی را نیز دارد.
Previously, the Taliban have refused to deal with Kabul, who they view as a puppet of the United States. They would rather deal with Washington directly or Pakistan. Taliban bombings, including the death of an American soldier, prompted the US to abruptly end those negotiations in September, but the White House has since tried to get talks back on track.
Moving on to island nation of Sri Lanka, where a new face is set to become the head of the government. Out of the record 35 candidates who were vying for the position, the real competition has narrowed down to 2 candidates. The ruling United National Party, Sajith Premadasa, and Gotabaya Rajapaksa from the opposition Sri Lanka People's Front Party. Today, we'll briefly tell you about both the front runners in the elections. Have a look.
While there are no official opinion polls in the island nation of Sri Lanka, Gotabaya Rajapaksa and Sajith Premadasa are the favourites for the top chair. The two have promised to fix up multiple layers of challenges the country faces today, whether it is the sluggish economy, a growing communal divide, or the poverty. Both expressed a strong will to work in their separate campaigns. Gotabaya Rajapaksa, the former defense secretary and brother of former president Mahinda Rajapaksa, is the leader of the Sri Lanka People's Front Party. He is running on a platform promising to prioritize security and economic reform. Gotabaya is immensely popular among Sri Lanka's powerful Sinhala Buddhist majority, who credited him with ending the island nation's 26-year-long civil war in 2009 and believe Colombo needs a seasoned hand after the April Easter Day bombings. Gotabaya vowed that if elected, he would prioritize safeguarding Sri Lanka's national security and reviving its economy, hit by a lull in tourism after the attacks.
අපේ රජයක් තුල ප්‍රථම කාර්යභාරය වන්නේ රට තුල පූර්ණ ආරක්ෂාව තහවුරු කිරීමයි. අපිට යලිත් මේ දිවයින ලෝකේ සුරක්ෂිතම රට බවට පත් කළ හැකි බව මම ඉතා විශ්වාසයෙන් ප්‍රකාශ කරනවා. ඔබේ දූදරුවන්ගේ ආරක්ෂාවේ වගකීම මා බාර ගන්නවා.
Sajitha Premadasa, another frontrunner, is the son of former President and Prime Minister Ranasinghe Premadasa. Premadasa, who holds a degree in economics, politics and international relations, is no rookie to political ring of the country. He has held several ministerial portfolios, including housing and health, since he was first elected to the legislation in 2000. Popular among rural poor, he is campaigning to eradicate poverty and improve housing under a slogan Shelter for All at 2025.
Nan selada kiyanna kemathi api rajayak hatiyata duppatkama turan kirima shanika shigragami weda pilivalak hatiyata kriyaatmaka karannata balaapuruth wenawa. Pavatina samurdhi weda satahana tavadurata shaktimat karamin ඉදිරියට ගෙන යමින් ඒ වැඩපිළිවෙල හරහා ප්‍රතිලාභ ලබා දෙනවා වගේම රණසිංහ ප්‍රේමදාස මැතිතුමාගේ ජනසවිය වැඩසටහනත් අපි නැවතත් වරක් ආරම්භ කරලා සමෘද්ධියයි ජනසවියයි දෙකම ලබා දීලා ඉතාමත්ම කෙටි කාලයක් තුළ දුප්පත්කම තුරන් කරන්නට අපි බලාපොරොත්තු වෙනවා.
The country's discourse has suffered a massive blow when some local Muslims, pledging their allegiance to Islamic State, blew themselves up in three churches and three hotels on 21st April. Islamic extremism has been at the fore of the debates and discussions since then, and political experts believe that the one who has successfully managed to convince electorate on this ground will take the crown.
The protests against the Pakistan's illegal occupation and their draconian taxation policies are steaming up in Gilgit-Baltistan as a large number of traders and public gather to register their dissent against the local administration in the region. Under the leadership of Awami Action Committee, the demonstrators voiced out their grievances and warned the Islamabad-ruled government against a further uproar in the coming times. We have a report.
Weeks-long protests against the taxation laws are gaining momentum and reaching wide across Gilgit-Baltistan. An anti-government demonstration called by Awami Action Committee has resonated with the mass, and people from all walks of life have joined in to demand a rollback. The committee, which has been fighting for the rights of the common people of Gilgit-Baltistan, says the tax imposition is part of Pakistan's larger and systematic design of further suppressing the indigenous. The leaders have warned of stepping up their movement if the government doesn't give in to their demands.
ये हमारा हुकूमत को जब से एक भी बार नहीं है जो मुतालिबात वहां पे हमने 25 तारीख को वहां पे उठाया है उसको मनो अंग तस्लीम किया जाए उस पे अमल दरामद होना चाहिए। नहीं हुआ तो ये एक्शन कमेटी फिर आवाम को लेकर रोडों पर आएगी, चाहे वो धरना दे दें, लॉन्ग मार्च करें, वो हमारा निर्देश से लाए अमल और मुख्तलिफ होगा।
The local are not wrong when they call these actions agenda-oriented. Pakistan is in dire need of money, and it looks up to its sole and perennial ally in Beijing for it. And in order to provide a resistance-free thoroughfare to China's flagship project CPAC, the locals whose land are under the project need to be driven out of the region. Hence, Islamabad is subjecting them every possible atrocity. A demographic change features among the top agendas to meet the need. It is not just the taxation, but Pakistan has used every trick in book to marginalize them. These constitutionally discriminated people are neither getting adequate electricity nor sufficient potable water.
Itna pani hone ke bawajood koi pani ka qillat nahi hone ke bawajood hame tarsaya ja raha hai. इनके लिए आप सबको चाहिए कि अपने हुकूक के लिए आप सबको इत्तेफाक और इत्तेहाद में होना चाहिए। आपने खुद देखा आज वज़ीर आज़म को कुछ भी नहीं देखे किया। आपको चाहिए कि आप लोग अपने हुकूक के लिए इत्तेफाक और इत्तेहाद लाजमी करना है। ये वफाकी पार्टियां आपको कुछ देने वाली नहीं है। जब तक आपका अपना एक मजबूत सेटअप हो, मजबूत पार्टी बने और ये अपना हुक मांग सकती है, वफाकी पार्टियों पे कभी भी भरोसा नहीं करना है।
For years, the region has been enduring the state-backed economic depredations. On one side, it has been exploited on several layers. It has been used as a dumpyard on the other occasions. However, people who had come to terms with this inhuman treatment are no more in mood to leave with the status quo. They are out on streets expressing dissent and demanding rights. Islamabad might be playing down the situation in its domestic power corridors, but a rebellion is certainly shaping up in illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan.
The bilateral ties between India and Nepal are marked with robust trade, growing political and cultural engagements, and people-to-people connection. The friendship between the two has only moved north in recent times, with both New Delhi and Kathmandu striving to further enhance the ties. While India has helped Nepal expand its trade and economy on one side, it has lent direct assistance for the reconstruction of earthquake-destroyed houses. Today, we show you how the Indian government has helped people owning a home who had lost their shelter after 2015 earthquake.
It's been few months since Rana Maya Jabra has found her new abode at the prime location in Gorkha Bazar. She has built this house with a tranche she received from the government reconstruction program backed by Indian assistance. She says that it was the people of the development program who convinced her into making a separate home for herself. Her previous house, which stood strong in the city, turned to rubble by the devastating earthquake of 2015. She spent her next 3 months in her neighbor's home. Although she had made a makeshift hut for herself, but could not live in it owing to the insecurity triggered by the quake aftershocks.
मैं नौ बनाऊं नहीं बंदा, अन 50,000 पाई है थी, पहले मासी आल्यो, अन ते अब हेर पौसी, अते 50,000 ले के मरवा दूं जरा. भनी जता पनि म गइरहने लौन लौन भन्ने म कराउन गइरहने अफिस अफिसमा कराउन जाने अनि त्यो हुनाले कुरा बुझ्दै आएँ होइन 50,000 मेरो के बन्छ र अब केही पनि बन्दैन हो भत्काएर यो अगाडिको कोठा भत्काएर एक कोठी बनाइदिए हुन्छ भने अनि यो भत्काएर एक कोठी अनि बनाइदिन्छु अनि यो बनाएपछि म खुसी छु मलाई डर लाग्दैन बस्दा पनि त्यत्रो मेघ बतास आउँदा नि चढ्किँदा नि मलाई डर लाग्दैन
Fortunes favored her as soon as a new house materialized. The tea shop in her house is generating enough income for her subsistence. And it's not just her, but numerous others too have been benefited with the housing reconstruction project running with the aid provided by New Delhi.
यस्ता घरहरु जो चाहिँ बन्न बाँकी छन् कोही बनिस भूकम्प पश्चात निर्माणाधीन चरणमा छन् हैन हो त्यस्ता घरहरुलाई चाहिँ हामीले सहजीकरण गरिरहेका छौ त्यस्ता घरमा चाहिँ हामीले विशेष गरी सहजीकरण भन्दा फेरि हाम्रो इन्जिनियरहरुले चाहिँ त्यसमा प्राविधिक रूपमा सुरु देखि नै अब त्यसलाई डीपीसी लेभल देखि नै माथिल्लो छाना तह सम्मै बीचको देखि हैन सुरु देखि नै छाना तह छाउँदा सम्म उहाँले चाहिँ
द गभर्नमेन्ट अफ इन्डिया is supporting the construction of as many as 50,000 houses. Around 27,000 of them are in Gorkha district. It appointed authorizing UNDP and UNOPS as socio-technical facilitation consultants for Gorkha and Nuwakot district respectively in March 2018. The reconstruction drive initiated by Government of India with UNDP's consultation in Gorkha district of Nepal has brought on smile and happiness over the face of beneficiaries here. The Indian government had committed $1 billion for the reconstruction of Nepal in form of grant and line of credit, out of which $115 million were allocated for reconstruction in housing sector, $100 million as grant, while 50 others as line of credit.
India is celebrating a row of festivals with traditional zeal and godliness. Recently, six devotees across India celebrated 550th birth anniversary of Guru Nanak Dev or Guru Purab in a majestic manner. It is the most important and sacred festival of the Sikh community or Sikhism. On the auspicious occasion, devotees also thronged the Golden Temple, Sikhism's holiest shrine, and offered prayers. Have a look.
Sikh devotees from several parts of India thronged Golden Temple as a festive spirit gripped the worshippers on the 558th anniversary of Guru Nanak Jayanti. Sikh devotees lit candles and lamps as they thronged the shrine to offer prayers, and the dazzling fireworks covering the night sky followed. The Golden Temple was beautifully decorated with lights and the environment was completely spiritual. Devotees also took part in Nagar Kirtan, where Sikhism's holiest scripture, the Guru Granth Sahib, decorated with flower petals, was carried in a palanquin.
ਅੱਜ ਅਸੀਂ ਇੱਥੇ ਗੁਰੂ ਨਾਨਕ ਦੇਵ ਜੀ ਦਾ 550 ਸਾਲਾ ਗੁਰਪੁਰਬ ਮਨਾ ਰਹੇ ਹਾਂ ਬੜੀ ਧੂਮਧਾਮ ਮਨਾ ਰਹੇ ਹਾਂ ਔਰ ਬੜੀਆਂ ਰੌਣਕਾਂ ਹੈ ਇੱਥੇ ਅਸੀਂ ਇਸ਼ਨਾਨ ਕਰ ਰਹੇ ਹਾਂ ਸਾਰੇ ਲੋਕ ਇੱਥੇ ਇਸ਼ਨਾਨ ਕਰ ਰਹੇ ਹਾਂ ਬੜੀ ਧੂਮਧਾਮ ਨਾਲ ਮਨਾ ਰਹੇ ਹਾਂ
The day is celebrated as a birth anniversary of Guru Nanak Dev, the first guru of Sikh community. Guru Nanak Dev, the first Sikh guru, was born in Nankana Sahib on the full moon day in 1469 in the Kartik month of the Hindu calendar. Children showcase their martial arts skills during the event as they indulge in sword fighting, among other forms of arts, a day ahead of the birth anniversary of the guru.
ਆਤਿਸ਼ਬਾਜ਼ੀ ਤੇ ਅਲੌਕਿਕ ਹੈਗੀ ਹੈ ਹਰ ਇੱਕ ਗੁਰਪੁਰਬ ਤੇ ਮਨਾ ਕੀਤੀ ਜਾਂਦੀ ਹੈ ਬਟ ਇਸ ਵਾਰੀ ਗੁਰੂ ਨਾਨਕ ਦੇਵ ਜੀ ਦਾ 550th ਹੈਗਾ ਤੇ ਇਸ ਕਰਕੇ ਦੇਖੋ ਕਿੰਨਾ ਵਧੀਆ ਨਜ਼ਾਰਾ ਹੈ ਲੋਕੀ ਆਨੰਦ ਲੈਂਦੇ ਪਏ ਆ ਇੱਕ ਵੀ ਕਹਿ ਸਕਦੇ ਯੂਨਿਟੀ ਦਾ ਪਰਵ ਅਸੀਂ ਮਨਾਉਂਦੇ ਪਏ ਆ
Sikhism was founded in the 15th century in Punjab, an area straddling the border between Pakistan and India, by Guru Nanak Dev. The festivities in the Sikh religion revolve around the anniversaries of the 10th Sikh Gurus. These Gurus were responsible for shaping the beliefs of the Sikhs. Their birthdays, known as Guru Purab, are occasions for celebration and prayer among the Sikhs.
This Guru Purab celebration, where the festivities received a boost owing to opening of Kartarpur corridor, will go down the line as historic. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.
You're watching Tag TV.